Republic of Ireland has always been a neutral country, and in World War II, that led to an extraordinary uprising amongst the army, and the repercussions lasted way beyond the conflict.
Larry Lamb went to Dublin to hear about Britain's Irish soldiers.
Wow. Dublin, capital of the Republic of Ireland. During the Second World War, thousands of men left the Southern Irish Army without permission. They deserted. One of the worst crimes a soldier can commit.
But the fascinating thing is, they weren't being cowardly or running away from danger as you might think. In fact, many of them were doing exactly the opposite and putting their lives on the line.
During the war, the Irish government stuck to its rigid policy of neutrality. While the Allied forces fought the Nazis, the soldiers in Ireland's army found themselves watching from the sidelines or posing for the newsreel cameras. So thousands of Irish soldiers deserted. Some left to go and find better paying jobs. But many wanted to see some real action and help stop the Nazis. So they joined the British Army instead and went to war.
When the war was over, the Irish soldiers knew they'd be in trouble for deserting. So many of them came home expecting to be court-martialed. But they were wrong.
After initially court-martialing some soldiers, the Irish government came up with a quicker solution. They dismissed a total of 4,983 deserters in one fell swoop. And they put their names on a blacklist, which made getting a job or claiming welfare almost impossible. Peter Mulvaney has been campaigning for a pardon for the men on the list.
This list was actually distributed right across the whole of Ireland. Right down to the post office, the library, the council office. So if somebody was on this list, you were gone.
You couldn't get a job.
You couldn't get a job. Employment here was mainly in the rural areas. It was government employment.
So you worked for the council or whatever?
Yeah, they were barred. I got angry about it. Yeah. It's how dare they treated people. Because these are personnel, these are Defence Force personnel, and they are entitled as persons subject to military law to be treated according to military law, and the right to a fair hearing.
So really what you're saying is that these men were actually entitled to a court-martial?
Exactly.
But the list punished more than just the soldiers whose names were on it. Many of the men were fathers, with families, and with no work. There was no food on the table. And many of the families experienced extreme hardship. The list was only supposed to bar men from state employment for 7 years, but many felt its impact for the rest of their lives. In Britain, these men would have been welcomed home as war heroes, but the Irish government at the time thought it was a fair solution to the problem of dealing with so many deserters.
They didn't have the administrative capacity to court-martial them. The Irish military was very small, and it was felt maybe it was easier to make such a list, one size fits all, draw it all up, put it together, and then you've dealt with the problem.
Shouldn't the fact that some of these men had fought the Nazis have made the difference?
Well, you really would think so, but one of the questions, of course, that we have to deal with in this, we've got a list of 4,983 names. We know they deserted the Irish Defence Forces, but we don't know what happened to them. A large proportion of them probably joined the Allies, but we can't say for certain. We also know that a proportion of them will have joined in the economic war effort in Britain. They went into the factories. But there must also be a minority of them who just vanished. Vanished into the woodwork, across the border, across maybe into the larger cities in the UK. We don't know where they went.
The Irish government has now announced an amnesty. But only for the men on the list who deserted to fight with the Allies. Not for any who deserted to go and find better paying jobs or simply disappear. Without proper records, we can't possibly know how many of the names this amnesty applies to. But that's not the point. The point is that the few surviving deserters will know, and so will the families of those who've passed away. For all of them, this is a very private reprieve.
The feedback I'm getting is that families are very happy. They feel that this has removed the stigma. It's historical baggage being taken off their backs.
Well, Dan has joined us to talk a little bit more. But for Ronan, have you heard about this?
I know nothing about this. It's really, really interesting. I would like to learn more about it, definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah, very much so.
Dan, why now then? Why have they issued amnesty now?
Well, it's a long time, and the two nations, Britain and Ireland, have resolved their differences. They've resolved the differences over Northern Ireland, and they're just normalising relations. And the Queen with the first abolitionist state to visit Ireland since last year, some pictures we got, since independence. And she visited some Republican sites and did some good diplomacy there. And it's just about the, you know, forgiving and moving on from the past, I think.
Yeah, and what was the strength of the feeling against Britain? I mean, interestingly seeing the Queen there.
Yeah, and I'm sure, you know, Ronan would agree. I've got lots of Irish family. I think that amongst people, there was never, like, vicious sort of anti-British or anti-Irish feeling. I mean, you know, there was obviously some issues, but the Irish government was particularly hostile because, you know, the Irish government was dominated by Sinn Féin. De Valera, who was the head of the government, had actually been condemned to death by the British army, you know, by the British during the uprising. So, yeah, and they'd fought a vicious war against it. So you've got to remember, it's a long time ago, the British army was the enemy, the absolute enemy, particularly for seen from government circles. Yeah. So, you know, and it seems hard for us to believe it now, but at the time, the British had carried out war crimes in Ireland. You couldn't believe Irish guys, a lot of Irish people couldn't believe there would be Irish people willing to fight for the British Army.
And the magazine, with the coronation.
Some magazines, if they celebrated the Queen's coronation, they were banned in Ireland. So there was that feeling. And if you wore poppies to certain pubs around, you know, Remembrance Day, you might get someone having a word with you and things like that. But, you know, that again, that's changed as time's moved on.
Yeah.
Was the situation the same in other neutral countries then?
Yeah, I mean, you can't blame people. They're desperate not to get brought into this war, the worst war the world had ever seen. So a place like Switzerland, people were actually prosecuted for helping Jewish people escaping from Germany. It seems incredible to believe it now, but they were, because the Swiss government was desperate not to be seen to take sides. And even in America, before America joined the war, you risked losing your American citizenship if you signed up to fight for one of the protagonists.